so welcome. We are going to be looking at how we use Visual Studio, specifically with developing game in Unreal Engine. But if you're looking to develop using native or C++ in order to code, it's going to be really useful for you to have an IDE, a program that you can use to read and conveniently write code as you go. And I've been using Visual Studio since I started. And we're going to be having a look at setting up Visual Studio to be developing a game. And we're going to start from the beginning as if we... I'm not going to go... But we're going to go from the start as if you've just got a clean install. So what we're going to do, the first thing that we're going to check out is how we reset your kind of Visual Studio setup. You can go down to this import and export settings. And that lets you reset all of the settings back to basic. And that'll change the layout of my window a little bit at the moment. It tells you what you want as your default settings. So we're going to be developing in C++ for Unreal. So we click the CPP one. And then if I click finish, we won't see that much change, but there'll be definitely some changes in the window now. So first thing that I'd like to show you as well is the kind of install that you need for Visual Studio. It should be quite self-explanatory. You install it. If you go into modify, you can get back to the screen you see when you're installing it, which is like what added extras do you want to include? But the main one that we're interested in is this game development with CPP. And then the second thing that I'd recommend doing, and this is quite an important one, if you're going to be using debugging, based on what engine version you're using in Unreal, you want to make sure that you've got the debug symbols. What that allows you to do is you can debug not just your own code, but you can debug the engine code. The next step then, you would pretty much be working in VS then. So there's two ways. Let's say that you'd started a new project. Let's close Visual Studio for now. So let's go ahead and open a project. So I'll go into Kattenberg. So this is where you would make a new project that I was on about. You'd choose game, you'd go to next, and then you would choose what type of template you want. And this is what I was on about. You choose whether or not you're going to do it in Blueprint. Okay, so I'm going to do a couple of things in here. So first off, I typically use an extension called Visual Assist, which I highly recommend. I'll talk about it a little bit later. When you create a project, you'll just be launching the editor. When I say editor, I mean the Unreal Engine editor. And you won't really be doing anything with Visual Studio. As you add more stuff to your project, you kind of need to update the solution to know about all of the new files and changes to your project. But you run that, and what it does is it'll generate a new solution for us, and it'll give you a warning once it's finished to pretty much say, oh, this has changed, I need to refresh normally. And so you'd refresh if there'd been any changes based on that. But I'd run that before, so there's no real changes for me. Once you've done that, you're essentially able to work entirely from Visual Studio. From now on, we're not going to be launching our project from Epic Games Launcher. You can attach with Debugger, and that'll launch the editor for you and allow you to actually debug when you need to as well. So first thing, let's have a look about setting up VS. So some of the things that I like to do when setting up VS initially is there is an extension called Unreal VS, which is the official from Epic. They make a small extension to help with a couple of things. So we're first going to go through trying to set that up. This is quite handy. This is a command line kind of parameters that you can add on. This button here is really nice. So if you remember earlier, I showed you the weird thing you do where you go, if we go back to where I was in my project, here we go in Kattenberg, that generate project files. So instead of always having to go to this location to do it, you can use this button here, this refresh projects. That will also generate your project files for you. And then we have this button here, the batch builder. First off, I want to show you that you can actually just get rid of stuff you don't need. And this is true of any of the toolbars at the top. The little drop down at the end, add remove buttons, and you can just get rid of the things that you're not going to use. So I like to try and clean down the things that I don't use. So the command line I do use, the refresh projects I do use, and the batch builder I won't use on a small project like this. And I'm going to take it off this menu because I don't need it. You can always get it back if you need, right? You can just come back in and enable the button. You can do some cool things in this box here, but one of the main uses I have of it is you can pass it like a map. That is one use of this command line, and there is extra things you can do. You can launch it so it builds, you can do some things to skip some sort of compiling, you can do things. So you can see that it's launched us into this map, and this map is my test scene. We were just talking about this top bar up here, and one thing that I don't like about this top bar is I can't see the argument on the end of it. All we need to do is tell these boxes to be wider. And so to do that, it's quite straightforward. You go to the end of the section that it is in. So if you go into customize, you can go in and you can change anything that is in that menu. We want to make this wider. So if you go to modify, You can go ahead and you can change how wide you want this to be. So I'm going to just set mine to like 325, let's say. We do that, we press close, and you can see now that that box has gone wide, and so I can actually see what's at the end of it. This comes in really handy. And if you don't understand this, it's also something that I just didn't know for ages what it means. This is basically telling you when you press compile and you're going to build, how much you need to build. So I tend to have it in debug game always. The downside is it's a bit slower. But what we're trying to address here is basically, how can we make this box bigger? And we've learned before that we can just go in, add remove buttons, and go down to the customize section. And then we just go to the line that we want. So this is our, we can make this a better width. Let's just go 180. There you go. I can actually see what it is. There we go. So if I press close now, we can now, whichever one of these we choose, we can actually see what version it's on. Okay, so that is how we can fix some of the kind of simple issues that have been in VS for a while, so that we know what configuration that we're building. What I like to do then is to customize my toolbar. So let's go on this first group. This is your kind of standard group. If I right click and we see what kind of toolbars that we've got up here. If I get rid of text editor, you'll see that some of them disappear. The ones that I find useful in here, navigate forward and backwards, super handy. Some of the things I don't use, the apply code changes, I've not had that working, but maybe it's something I don't understand. So I'm going to turn that one off. We then have browser link. No, it's not even up there. Finding files. And then we have some extra ones down here. But that has made this a bit smaller for us now, at least. We basically just have things that we know what they do. Then we've got our Unreal VS that we've already tidied up. And then we've got another block over here, which is our editor ones, right? There's one extra menu that I do recommend that we have on here as well. And there's one called the build menu. Now, if I'm honest with you, the most useful thing I get out of this is this cancel button. So the cancel I find useful here. And what I'd remind you about is that there is extra things in here like debug, which will give you a bunch of debug options as well. What happens is you'll notice VS changes. The toolbar at the bottom, or this bar along the bottom, will change from blue to orange. And when you do that, it changes the configuration of VS a little bit. And so it'll enable that debugging. And you'll also notice that this bottom section of the screen changes as well. We get new windows. At the bottom, we've currently just got output. So we've kind of set up our toolbars now. There's some options we're going to go through and configure. I know this is a lot of setup stuff, but this is kind of things that I've learned. Once you get more comfortable with using Visual Studio, these are just things that you learn over time, or you feel comfortable enough to switch off because you know that you never use them, you know? I think we'll probably have a look at this window that's over here, because we got code files along here, and this will show you the different projects that you have. As we're working in Unreal, we'll have UE4 as our engine as a separate project. Now, what we've got then is our Kattenberg project, or whatever the name of your project is. This is where you'll see pretty much the structure of your code folders. If I'm honest with you, with CPP, you generally can just jump into the header and you get an idea of the classes, the structure anyway, you know? It still may be useful for some people who like using like the mouse and to use this side menu as well. The error list. So if you compile and there's a problem, you will see the wonderful error list. Now, in something like C#, this is wonderfully useful. What happens is we just look at the output and I use that to determine where the kind of errors are. So we'll see, here we go. We've got a bunch of errors, but this is what I use. Now, this is where like you'll get a list of stuff. Like sometimes it's right, don't get me wrong. But generally when you're compiling, you want to make sure that you've got the option off that this doesn't automatically show. So the way to do that, if we just go into our tools and our options, if you go into or projects and solutions. So this is something that I personally recommend turning off. Otherwise, it will always bring up this window, even if you close it. Another thing that I've done doing options sometimes is if I want to change the font size, not like you can control mouse wheel to make your actual code font bigger, but sometimes like this output list or your find results. So can you see how large this is? That's gigantic. So if you want to change the font settings for that, if you can go into the options the way I did before, but you can just search here. If I just go font settings, change the font color, yeah, that's probably the one. We go into this window and you choose, you can change fonts and that if you want. Generally here, what I've done, you go into the output window and you can just change the size of this. So if it's a bit small for you, but when I'm streaming, it's quite useful. If I'm debugging, it helps chat be able to see like, what am I trying to understand? The other thing I want to show you now, this is the last bit of setup in Visual Studio, if I'm honest with you, just how you can move around windows and kind of get it set up as you want. And this follows on from pinning is super handy, as is dragging and rearranging your windows. So one thing that I tend to do is to try and rearrange it so that it actually, this window goes across and then I can split this window in half and get more information out. I can whack this on the side of this window instead, and then this takes up less room. So if I go to I think it's in view, isn't it? View, and then there should be a bookmark window. Yeah, there it is. So if we click on that, you can now see that I've got a bookmarks bar as well. But what I want to do is I want to drag this across to be on the side of this window. So then I can keep my bookmarks over here, so I can jump around code to bits that I want to. The other thing is I generally sometimes do find it handy just to pin these windows down out the way to give us more kind of vertical space in our window. So the scroll bar is pretty useful. All the results that you find are going to be highlighted in this kind of brown, maroon sort of color. It's also useful to know, have I actually included something? But we can change this scroll bar to be a little bit more useful as well. Yeah, and in here you can do use bar mode. That's the one. So if you tick that instead. Okay, so this gives you like your little preview. It also like highlights like changes in your document. So if I was to write, you see I get this little marker on the side saying that I've changed it. And the other things you're seeing is these breakpoints as well. So that map mode is pretty useful on the scroll bar. A couple of things then that I wanted to talk about was the tabs. When you start working in a big code base with other people, and then you end up having to open files just to see how stuff works, even if you're not changing it, it can get a bit of a mess. This is not good. I don't know how it works memory-wise, but I like to try not to have too many things open at once. And one of the main features I use is this pinning. So if I was going to be working on this file that I was in earlier, let's say, I would pin this one. And so one of the things I like to do, we do lose a bit of vertical space doing this, but if you go into the settings for it, put in some settings that will make these stand out a lot more, show pinned tabs in a separate row. If you do that, well, that puts them all on the top. You can choose like where new tabs go. You can actually change, tabs can be on the side if you prefer to keep the vertical space. I tried it for a while, but I couldn't get used to it. So there's a thing called previewing that we saw a bit of earlier. You can turn that off and control that in there as well. The thing where if we have this on, that it'll do a preview of it. The problem is I have these files opened already, so it's not doing a preview. Button here, and you can click it to say, oh, I want to keep that open. But otherwise, if you click on another file, it's gone. Enabling preview is quite useful if you're only kind of referencing files. It can be pretty handy. So one of the main things that I tend to do is just close all but pinned. I'll pin everything I need, and then I can just go ahead and just close all but pinned. Okay, so yeah, that's how I work with tabs. The final few things then that I want to show then. So first off, this bookmarks window. So bookmarks are super handy, in my opinion, and they just allow you to put like key points in code that you find yourself revisiting. Me personally, sometimes I like to use bookmarks for these kind of like, this is where this certain bit of code happens, and I know I might want to go back there in future. And so they're easy enough to add. You just, when you're there, I think you press Control and then you can tap K twice. So if we wanted to add one here for the setup character, Control K two times, and then it adds a bookmark, and it makes it a bit easier to jump between key parts as you're working. So it's pretty handy, in my opinion, at least. Now, there's a window called the call hierarchy as well. And this is something I feel I probably should use more. But also, it can kind of lock up your Visual Studio if you use it at the wrong time. So essentially, it's a way of you select a function and you just see, well, where is this called? And then you get presented with these options. We want to see calls to turn card and calls from turn card. This will look through and see where in your code is calling this function. So we can see there's two places that call turn card. It's in this function reveal card and unreveal card. But yeah, I find that quite useful sometimes just to know, okay, if I'm changing this logic, what calls it? Yeah, I think that's pretty much all of the kind of setting up your editor, at least, that I wanted to go through. Hopefully there's been a few little pointers that of setting it up, making sure that you feel that your editor's clean, that you're in an environment where you're not got clutter on the screen that you don't know, that you don't need. And that's what this next section is going to be about.